These are people who mainstream, whitewash, sanitize the ideas and tactics of Antifa. And this is the group that I find more concerning, because this is what gives Antifa the moral legitimacy that they've been thriving on since 2016 to continue to organize and go out and wreak havoc on the streets, and depending on what city it is, sometimes being able to do it with impunity.
Joining me now is Andy Ngo. He is the journalist who was brutally attacked by Antifa at a rally in Portland, Oregon. Andy, thank you for being here with me. First off, I want to ask you how you're doing today.
I'm exhausted and in a lot of pain, and be dealing with some of the emotional stuff, as I recall what happens to me over and over. But I'm pushing myself to do all this media engagement because I don't want this story to just be one of some random guy gets beat up in a city and then the story goes away. I'm hoping that over and over the public has to be confronted with the brutality of this militant movement called Antifa. And it's a movement that I've been sounding the alarms about for over a year to the public and to politicians, and nobody seemed to be heeding my warnings. And now with this, what happened to me, I'm by far not the first, won't be the last. And unless some changes happen, other innocent people will get caught up in the violence.
Yeah, absolutely. So I want to get everyone up to speed. You were attacked at this rally that you were covering. It was a dual protest rally. A group known as the Proud Boys, they were there. Antifa showed up. They threw milkshakes at you. They attacked you. You ended up going to the hospital, and you suffered a brain hemorrhage. You were released on Sunday, and you know, we can see the bruises and the cuts on your face, and you know, you already mentioned that you're not feeling so great. But I mean, how do you go forward from this? I know that you're wanting to get the word out about Antifa. I've called Antifa a domestic terrorist group for a while. I've also been covering it for the past couple years. I've seen this violence. I know it's a violent group. Their ideas scare me in general, but it's the violence. And it seems like the media and some of the Democratic politicians are providing cover for Antifa, whether it's that they're not speaking out against Antifa, they don't condemn them publicly. We've heard some talking heads in the media, like CNN's Chris Cuomo, who actually said that they do good things. Let me just read you the quote here. I'm sure you heard him say this as well. He said, "You can talk about Antifa. I've watched them in the streets protesting in different situations, okay?" He says, "There are certainly aspects of them that are true to the cause, that is a good cause. They want social justice. They want whatever they want in that context." Social justice, do you agree with this in any way?
Okay, there are lots of points to that question. I'll try to address them one by one. Clarification on one thing. I've seen from media that it's not from Portland has gotten some things wrong about what happened on Saturday. There were three distinct separate events happening, and they did there was a men's rights activist group that was held holding an event at Pioneer Courthouse Square. The Proud Boys were doing a patriotic flag waving event at the waterfront, and then Antifa was holding their demonstration at another part. So this is all in downtown, relatively close to one another, but separate. The Proud Boys and Antifa never made contact that day at all. However, what happened was Antifa, after my brutal mob beating, marched to Pioneer Courthouse Square, where the men's rights activist group was, and that was where more rioting happened. And some of your viewers may have seen the video there. That was where the middle-aged man and the gentle the elderly gentleman had their heads bashed in with deadly weapons. So for that, to bring up the one of the other points you bring up with the media, what happened to me brings shines light specifically on the extremist violence of Antifa, and I never give them the dignity of calling them anti-fascists. It's, they're masters of doublespeak, so you see it in the name Antifa, which they say is short for anti-fascist. They're anything but. They're a paramilitary movement of violent, radical anarchists and communists who are agitating for political revolution. They absolutely hate the concept of the nation state. They hate liberal democracy. So they hate a lot of things beyond the far right and Nazis. Okay, so I have to make that clear. But beyond the small group of actual violent armed militants, you have a much larger concentric circle of what I call nonviolent Antifa sympathizers. And these are people who work in progressive media, who have a lot of influence on social media as well. Some of them work in center-left mainstream media as well. These are people who mainstream, whitewash, sanitize the ideas and tactics of Antifa. And this is the group that I find more concerning, because this is what gives Antifa the moral legitimacy that they've been thriving on since 2016 to continue to organize and go out and wreak havoc on the streets, and depending on what city it is, sometimes being able to do it with impunity. I think Portland is probably the city where not only are they one of the cities where they're most active in the United States, but where the law enforcement, those who are pulling the strings on law enforcement, are empowering the militant far left to go out and enact violence for political purposes.
Yeah, you mentioned other people injured. I think there were several people injured. I think last report I read said somewhere around 8 people, including police officers. So, yeah, I mean, they'll pretty much attack anyone. I've witnessed attacks myself at an Antifa rally here in Washington, D.C. I was doing a Facebook Live, and behind us, I looked like a minority man, a journalist documenting what was going on. I don't know what his political views were. He could have been liberal, just there for the day. They knocked his camera out of his hand. I mean, they were punching him. It got extremely violent here. And I've been reading some of the headlines and hearing what some of the people in the media are saying. I've been reading some of the social media posts. And there are some people out there that are accusing you of kind of like staging this or setting this up, or that you wanted to get hurt so that you could get a platform and the media attention. What do you say back to those people who are kind of, I guess, like victim blaming and shaming?
I'm gathering receipts of all these defamatory allegations and forwarding them to my lawyer. There were plenty of cameras that day, not just from people sympathetic to Antifa recording me on their side. There's cameras in the city. Mind you, where I was brutally mobbed happened right in the heart of downtown, in front of some of the most important institutions of law enforcement in the city. And this is sort of the irony of the anarchy and the lawlessness. As I was getting beaten on my head, I could actually still see the Justice Center, which houses the sheriff's office, the central police precinct. And so there are lots of cameras, and the evidence will come out to, I wouldn't use the word vindicate. I think it's been very clear from the evidence that's already out there that I was the non-aggressor here. And that's something I also reiterate for the record, that the attack on me was completely unprovoked on my part. And the sick thing about people who are trying to justify somehow the violence against me, calling me provocateur, I think it shows that these so-called defenders of the free press don't give a damn about the free press. if you're willing to concede that a camera is provocation, don't call yourself a journalist.
Yeah, this is an attack on a free press. It's an attack just on the First Amendment in general. So, again, you're pushing back, and I agree with you. You have the right to be out there. You have the right to film. You have the right to ask for interviews in a public area. And in a sense, doesn't Antifa want this? Don't they want the media attention? Because without it, they kind of don't really exist. And as someone who has attended Antifa events as well, I know going into it that it could get dangerous and violent, that violence can escalate fast. I always hope that I won't get hurt. I don't feel like I'm provoking or asking for it if I were to ever get hurt. But I have the right to be there and to film and tell a story. And I believe that's what you were doing there as well.
Antifa doesn't just want media coverage. They want a specific type of media coverage. They're masters of propaganda, misinformation, and disinformation. They've hoodwinked a lot of sympathizers into providing them that favorable coverage. In Portland, you can look at the local alternative progressive newspapers for that coverage, and even sometimes a paper record will provide favorable coverage to them. And then, of course, beyond that, there's a much larger media outlets nationally and internationally who I would say carry water for Antifa's ideologies and extremism. So for those who report the straight news about what they do, so I've witnessed them menace, harass, and intimidate, and go after the local news televisions. Now, those journalists, you know, are doing the straight hard news reporting, and they don't shy away from talking about what Antifa does. And for that reason, they've also been targeted. There's video evidence of this happening, particularly during when Antifa militants and their allies sieged the local ICE building in Southwest Portland last summer. I wrote about this for the Wall Street Journal at the time for 5 weeks. So there was a lot of media coverage from there. And some of the local journalists were attacked. And all those attacks at that time worked for the news television. But of course, those in the progress in either The Guardian or the Portland Mercury and left-wing publications, it's very telling that they are allowed to do their work unimpeded.
I wanted to read you a couple headlines. There's one from Vox News. It's titled, "The Assault on Conservative Journalist Andy Ngo Explained." It's by Zach Beauchamp. In this article, he kind of labels you as some sort of like right-wing extremist. He says that you're the editor of Colette. It's widely seen as a major hub of the intellectual dark web. So it's in a sense, they're trying to discredit you. And I don't know why. Does that make any difference on what happened to you? I don't think so. Even if you were this right-wing extremist of the dark web, you still don't deserve to be hit. Now, of course, I know your work, and I would say that you're not a right-wing extremist. I would call you a journalist. What say you?
I haven't read this particular piece, but there's been other ones published with similar slants and biases, and I saw something in Huffington Post, you know, kind of like what you would expect. So I think what these writers recognize is that it's a bipartisan issue that freedom of the press is sacred, right? So they cannot admit that a professional journalist like me was attacked in such a brutal way. Instead, they use ways to sort of delegitimize me. Okay, the Oregonian, which is our paper of record here, describes me as right-wing and a provocateur. Others will use words like right-wing blogger or YouTuber, something like that. And I don't want to like toot my horn, but like I'll lay out my credentials. Okay, I went straight from being a student journalist at Portland State not that long ago for the student paper, to contributing to the Wall Street Journal, to National Review, to the Spectator, to the American Spectator, to New York Post. I was invited to join the editorial team of Quillette, the online magazine. So it's part of the strategy. Pay attention to it. Look at the bigger picture, I would say, of what they're trying to do.
You were attacked by Antifa, and now you're kind of being attacked by the media. Would you agree with that?
I would say there's a section of media that is going after me, those Antifa cheerleaders, I would say. However, I've seen such overwhelming support that has been bipartisan that I appreciate so much, because under this polarized climate, it can be, unfortunately, intimidating to express solidarity to someone from what you perceive to be on the other side. I think Andrew Yang was very brave to be the first Democratic presidential candidate to come out publicly in support of me. Then I saw Eric Solwell did as well. As far as I know, none of the others have. But, you rightfully pointed out ignorant things that CNN hosts have said before about Antifa. At the same time, I want to mention that Jake Tapper and Brian Stelter have expressed support of me and condemned the violence. So I'm hoping that this moves the national discourse on far left militancy in a way that is not partisan. I don't want my story to be seen as an attack on a right-wing journalist or conservative journalist. I want to see really as an attack on American decency and an attack on the free press, period.
Yeah, I saw you did an interview on CNN, and it seemed pretty fair. They let you tell your story. But there was a headline attached to the interview that you did, and the headline says, "Conservative journalist blames assault at Portland protest on Antifa activists." Like, who else are you to, like, what type of headline is that?
Yeah, I believe it was. So it's interesting when you contrast the headlines that CNN and other left of center and left wing media publications used to describe Jussie Smollett's allegations. And at that time, they didn't use any language like how they're using to describe me. Nothing like allege or says. It was Jussie Smollett was attacked in hate crime.
Yeah,
impossible hate crime, even. So, in his story, of course, as everybody knows by now, at that time didn't have any. The attack wasn't caught on camera. It was outrageous. There wasn't evidence for a lot of it, and even as the story fell apart, a lot of people dug in their feet.
There are still a big portion of our society that stand with Jussie Smollett. It's incredible. But yeah, I mean, a journalist blames assault at Portland protest on Antifa activists. I mean, who else are you supposed to blame? It's outrageous. I saw that your attorney, Harmeet Dhillon, she's representing you. She plans to sue, quote, everybody that the law permits. So do you know who you all are going after?
Right now, I'm taking things literally an hour at a time. We haven't, by this point now, I've gone over my attack in detail. In particular, last night, the Wall Street Journal published my first writing describing in detail what happened. I just want to reiterate that I'm dealing with a brain hemorrhage that I'll continue to suffer for quite a while. And unfortunately, your listeners and viewers may hear some type of weirdness in my speech pattern. It's stemming from that. I'm taking this very slowly. What is immediately on my mind, though, is that I want to see all of those who are involved in either attacking me or providing support, providing material support. I want all of them to be held accountable for their actions under the law.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree with you. And hopefully people will come forward and start to help to identify anyone else who was involved. Well, Andy, I hope that you recover quickly. And thank you again for sharing your story. I know that you're not feeling well.
Thank you for having me on.